Welcome to the next lecture of electrical machines. We were discussing the DC machine, and in today's lecture we are going to discuss the construction of the DC machine and its constructional features. So basically, any DC machine will have two basic parts. One part is known as the stator, which is standstill, and the second part is basically the rotor, which is rotating. So the two parts that we have is stator and the rotor. So stator is standstill, whereas the rotor is basically rotating. Stator has salient poles that are excited by one or more field windings. Here the word salient means projecting out. So the stator is basically having the poles which is projecting out and are excited by one or more field windings. That is, you will be having a poles which are projecting out, and then the conductors will be wound over it to produce the flux. The armature winding is located on the rotor. So rotor and armature will be used alternatively in case of the DC machine, because the armature winding is located on the rotor with current flowing through it by carbon brushes making contact with the copper commutator segment. So basically the commutator is having in touch with the carbon, and the current is being tapped from the carbon brushes. This current is produced in the armature winding, which is placed in the rotor. Both the main poles and the armature core are made up of laminated materials to reduce the core losses. So in the magnetic circuit we have discussed that core loss can be hysteresis loss or an eddy current loss, and it has to be reduced with the help of a lamination. Hence the main pole and the armature core are laminated. Big DC machines also have commutating poles between the main poles of the stator. So apart from the main poles, you will be having commutating poles for the big DC machines. Each commutating pole has its own winding, also known as commutating winding or otherwise interpoles or compoles. So apart from the main poles, you are having the commutating poles which is present in the main pole of the stator. These commutating poles will carry the winding which are known as the commutating winding, otherwise known as interpoles or compoles. The field winding are located around the pole cores and are connected in series or shunt with the armature circuit. So shunt means parallel. So as we see that the field's pole is basically a salient pole we have, and we have the winding through which the flux is produced. So these windings may be connected in series or in shunt with the armature circuit. So armature is present here. Armature conductors are present in the rotor, and it is connected with the field coils. The shunt winding is made up of many turns of relatively thin wire, whereas the series winding has only a few turns and is made up of thicker wire. So the difference between a shunt winding and series winding: shunt winding is the parallel winding which produces the flux, and series winding is connected in series with the armature. The connection of shunt winding construction is, it will have many number of turns. So it will have many number of turns of relatively thin wire. The wire will be very thin and long, many number of turns will be there. Whereas when we go for the series winding, it will have only a few turns, and it is made up of thicker wire. The series and shunt winding are located on the D axis or the field axis. So D axis is known as the direct axis. So the series and shunt winding are basically located on the D axis or the direct axis, that is the field axis, because the air gap flux distribution due to the field winding is symmetrical at the center line of the field poles. So if you see, the field poles are in this way, and you have the armature or the rotor which is basically rotating. So the series and shunt winding, so these are basically the field which is owned on the poles, are located on the D axis or the field axis. So here you have the main field line which is passing, so it is located on the D axis because the air gap flux, so these are the basically the air gap that is present between the pole and the magnet on the rotor has to be symmetric at the center line of the field poles. Both the compensating winding and commutating winding brushes are located on the Q axis. Q axis is known as the quadrature axis. So we have two type of axis. One is D axis, that is the direct axis, and other you have the Q axis, that is known as the quadrature axis. So the series and shunt winding will be located in the D axis, and the compensating or the commutating winding are located on the Q axis because it is at 90 degree electrical degree from the D axis and represents the neutral zone. So this is your main field pole lines, and 90 degree you will be having the Q axis. So this is your D axis and this is your Q axis. So on the Q axis you will be having the compensating and the commutating windings. So if you see the overview of the different parts of the DC machine, then you can see that here you have the poles which are salient type and it is located at the stator. So it is located at the stator, which is basically the stationary part. So here you have the stator, which is the stationary part, and this is what we are rotating. So it is basically the rotor. So rotor will have the armature conductor. So here you can see all the armature conductor is located inside the rotor with a sign positive and dot, indicating the magnetic field and current direction. So here in this way you can see the commutator segment which is present inside the armature, and there are two brushes which are settled on the commutator through which the current will be tapped. So the current will be tapped through the brushes which are present at the commutator. This axis, that is the axis of the main field poles, is known as the direct axis, where the axis which is at 90 degree to the main field axis is known as the quadrature axis. So you will be having the field coils which is present in the field poles. So these are the field coils, and it is present in the field poles which is producing the flux, and there will be a small air gap between the field poles and the rotor. So here we can see the commutating field winding. So commutating field winding will be present in the Q axis as we have defined. So it is present at the Q axis, and the series field winding and the shunt field winding will be present in the D axis. So you will be having one winding which is compensating winding, which is present in the pole faces. So these all things we will be discussing into more detail. So if we look in terms of the winding and understand, so here you have the armature or the rotor which is rotating with the two brushes. So this is brush number one and this is brush number two, made up of carbon. So the main field pole line, so here you have the poles, and this is the axis which is known as the D axis or the direct axis, and the perpendicular of that will be having the Q axis. So we can see the commutating winding and the compensating winding are present in the Q axis, whereas the series field winding or the shunt field winding will be connected in the D axis line. Now let us see the cutout section model of a DC machine. So if we see the scattered form of the various parts of the DC machine and what are the essential parts of the DC machine, then we will look that the armature, this is the armature which is present having the conductor, and the commutator is located here which is connected along with the armature, and this total phase is known as the rotor, which is placed inside the core of the stator. So you have a magnetic frame or yoke which is protecting all the parts. And here you have the field coil and the pole core, which is responsible for the production of the flux. So there will be having a brush assembly, brush holder and brush spring ring that are there to tap the current. The end housing is used to connect all the parts of the DC machine to form a one single equipment. So one by one, we will discuss the parts and see the essential features. So the first one will discuss the magnetic frame, or which is known as the yoke. So the outer cylindrical frame to which the main poles and interpoles are fixed is known as the yoke. So yoke is basically the outer cylindrical frame. Here the main poles and interpoles are fixed. It also helps to fix the machine on the foundation. So basically the machine has to be present at the foundation level. So if you take this to be a foundation, then it helps to fix the machine. The two purpose that the yoke serve is basically it provides mechanical protection to the inner part of the machine, which are very delicate. So you will be having mechanical protection. Second, it will provide a low reluctance path. So S will be low, hence the flux establishment will be more, that we have discussed in the magnetic circuit. So basically it is serving these two purpose. It is providing a mechanical protection and it is providing a low reluctance path to the magnetic flux. What is the yoke made up of? So yoke is made up of cast iron for a smaller machines. Now if you have a larger machine, then it is made up of cast steel instead of iron, or fabricated rolled steel. The reason being is that these materials have better magnetic properties as compared to cast iron. So steel will be better than the iron in terms of establishment of the flux. Second feature that we are going to discuss parts is the pole core and the pole shoe. So if you see, you have the pole core where the field windings are placed. So we have seen the shunt winding and the series winding that are present in the pole core, and this is the figure for the field winding, which is present in the former, and the winding ends will be connected with the armature winding to produce the flux. So it is fixed to the magnetic frame or yoke by bolts. So bolts will be used to fix the magnetic frame to the magnetic frame. They serve the following purpose. So what is the purpose we have? It is supporting the field or exciting coil. So exciting coil is the one which is responsible for production of the flux. So the pole core and pole shoe are basically supporting the field coils. It spread out the magnetic flux over the armature periphery more uniformly. So the flux has to be moved uniformly, spread out. So it will be helping the pole core and pole shoe will help the magnetic flux to spread out uniformly. Since pole shoes have larger cross section, the reluctance of the magnetic path is reduced. So the reluctance will reduce. Obviously, it will help in establishment of the flux. So pole shoes have larger cross sectional area. And what is it made up of? It is made up of thin cast steel or wrought iron laminations, which are riveted together under hydraulic pressure. So pole core and pole shoe is again made up of cast steel, similarly to what we have seen in the earlier, the yoke made up of. Third part that we are going to discuss is basically the field or the exciting coils. So enameled copper wire is used for the construction. So we have been discussing the shunt winding and the series winding. So these are made up of enameled copper wire. Okay, the coils are wound on the former and then placed around the pole core. So coils will be wound on the former. So we have seen the former is basically a cross-sectional area, and here the coils will be wound. Okay, now when a DC current is passed through the field winding, it magnetizes the poles which produce the required flux. The field coils for all the poles are connected in series, in such a way that when current flows through them, the adjacent poles attain opposite polarity. So you will be having the poles north pole and the adjacent pole, it will be having opposite polarity. Then you will have a pole north, then you will have south. So in this way the poles will be there. So the field coils which are present in the poles are connected in series so that the current flows through them and opposite polarity is attained. Next part that we are going to discuss is the armature core. So it is basically cylindrical in shape and keyed to the rotating shaft. So we see that armature is the one which is rotating and it is present in the rotor of this, which connected in the rotor. So it will be a cylindrical in shape. So here you can see how it is cylindrical in shape, having the slot and armature stampings, and all the field conduct this armature core having a teeth shaped structure where the slots are having the conductors. So here all the conductors are present which are known as the armature windings, and they are connected in proper fashion to form the lap winding or the wave winding. So outer periphery slots are cut which accommodates the armature winding. So the outer periphery, if you see the of the armature, which is cut to form the slots which are basically carrying the winding. So the armature core serves the following purpose. What are the purpose the armature core is serving? It will house the conductor in the slot. So it is first carrying the conductor, that is the armature winding, and it is providing an easy path for magnetic flux. So everywhere the magnetic flux has to establish easily, otherwise the EMF will not be established. Now, since armature is the rotating part of the machine, reversal of flux takes place in the core, hence hysteresis loss are produced. So we have seen the BH curve of the magnetic material. So the BH curve is the reversal of the flux. Due to reversal of the flux, there will be a hysteresis losses occurring and the armature is rotating. Hence, to minimize this loss, we are using silicon steel as the material used for the construction. So when it rotates, it cuts the magnetic field and EMF is induced in it in accordance with Faraday's law. And this EMF which is induced will produce a circulating current which is responsible for the loss, which is known as the eddy current loss. Now, if you have to reduce this eddy current loss, your armature core has to be laminated. In other words, we say that 0.3 to 0.5 mm thick stampings are used for the construction. So in order to reduce the eddy current loss, you have to laminate the core, and in order to minimize the hysteresis loss, you have to use silicon steel as the material. So each lamination or stamping is insulated from the other by varnish layer. So you are using a varnish to laminate the stampings. Next, we will discuss the armature winding. So we have seen the armature core and it is having a slot in the outer periphery where the armature windings are present in the slots. So what are the armature windings that we'll discuss? The insulated conductor housed in the armature slots are suitably connected, known as armature winding. So armature will have some slots in which the winding will be present or the conductor will be present. These conductor are insulated, hence it is suitable connection is known as armature winding. So armature winding acts at the heart of the DC machine. So if you tells the what's the heart of the DC machine, it is basically the armature winding. So it is place where one form of power is converted to the other form. So we know that in DC machine you can operate it as a generator or you can operate it as motor. So it will be connected in such a way that the energy conversion take place from either the mechanical to electrical or electrical to mechanical. On the basis of connection, there are two type of armature windings are there. One is known as the lap winding, another is known as the wave winding. So armature windings can be of two type based on how you are connecting in the slots. So they are lap winding and wave winding. So if you see the lap winding, it is basically the connections where the number of parallel path is equal to the number of poles. So number of parallel path is denoted by A. so it be equal to number of poles, then it is known as the lap winding. So here the machine, if having a P number of poles and Z number of armature conductor, then there will be P parallel path, and each path will have Z by P conductor in series. So we have seen that the field winding has to connect in series, then if P is the number of poles and Z is the total number of armature conductor, then you will be having Z by P number of conductor in each parallel path which should be connected in series. The number of brushes will be equal to number of parallel path. Now in the lap winding, the brushes will be equal to the total number of parallel path. So here you can see that Z by P conductor are in series, and you will be having P parallel path, because the number of parallel path is equal to number of poles and it is equal to number of brushes that you will be having. So out of which the half brushes are positive and the remaining half brushes are negative. So if you see the divide B by 2, that is number of poles divided by 2 will be positive and other half will be negative. The second winding, armature winding, we are going to discuss is the wave winding. So here the connection is such that the number of parallel paths are only 2 irrespective of the number of poles. So whatever the number of poles, you will be having the number of parallel path as 2. So that is fixed. So number of parallel path is 2 always, and it is not dependent on the poles. So if a machine is having Z number of armature conductor, then Z by 2 conductor will be in series and it will form 2 parallel path. So for Z conductor, you will be having Z by 2 conductor in series, and your parallel path will always be fixed at 2. In this case, the number of brushes is also equal to 2. So we can say that number of parallel path is equal to 2 is equal to number of brushes. Okay, so here the poles has nothing to do with the parallel connection or the brushes. Next important part we will be discussing is the commutator. So it is the most important part of a DC machine, or one of the important part we can say, and it serves the following purpose. So it connects the rotating armature conductor to the stationary external circuit through the brushes. So we know that the armature is basically rotating, so it means that the current that is produced in the armature is also rotating, and it is very difficult to tap a moving current. So in order to tap the moving current to the external circuit, we have to use commutator. So it will connect the rotating armature conductor to the stationary external circuit through brushes. So brush will be there, which will use to tap the current in the external circuit. Second important function that the commutator is having is basically it is converting the AC, which is induced in the armature conductor, into a unidirectional current. So we are discussing the DC machine. So obviously at the terminals we should get DC rather than AC, whereas inside the machine you will be having an AC supply. So this function of conversion of AC into unidirectional will be done with the help of a commutator, and then you will be getting an alternating torque into a unidirectional or a continuous torque produced in the armature for the motor action. So for the motor, you require a continuous torque or unidirectional torque that is possible with the help of a commutator, and in case of a generator, you will get unidirectional EMF. So commutator is basically a cylindrical in shape and is made up of wedge-shaped hard-drawn copper segment. So this is the figure of a commutator. You can see that commutator is basically cylindrical in shape and it is wedge-shaped. So you will be having a wedge-shaped which will have a number of connections. So each commutator segment will be connected with the mica insulation will be there, and copper segment riser is there. You have an end ring, adjusting nut, and a metal sleeve which is connected. So segments which the commutator segment, so we have discussed that there will be different segments in the commutator. So these segments 1, 2, 3 which are present in the commutator are insulated from each other by thin sheet of mica insulation. So the segments are held together by means of two V-shaped rings that fit into the V groups cut into the segment. So obviously the segments will be holding together by means of two V-shaped ring. So you have some end ring which is V-shaped and it is holding the segment. So each armature coil is connected to the commutator segment through riser. So you have seen that the commutator segment will be there, and this commutator segment will be holding the armature conductor. So this is the armature where the conductor out will come, and it will be holding through this commutator segment with the help of a riser. Next we will discuss the brushes. So brushes are pressed upon the commutator and form the connecting link between the armature winding and the external circuit. So this is your armature which is rotating, and all the conductors are present inside the armature slot. So obviously the current that is produced is rotating, and you have to tap the current outside in the external circuit, and that is done with the help of brush which is present from into the commutator. They are usually made of high grade carbon. So it is made up of carbon because carbon is conductive material, and at the same time in powdered form provides lubricating effect on the commutator segment. So brushes are made up of high grade carbon because it is both conducting as well as having a lubricating effect. So brushes are held in particular position around the commutator by brush holder and rocker. So these two help to connect the brush in a particular position in the commutator. So what is a brush rocker? So brush rocker is basically holds the spindles of the brush holder. So brush holder, and then it is fitted onto the stationary frame of the machine, which is the yoke, okay, with nuts and bolts. By adjusting its position, the position of the brushes over the commutator can be adjusted. So if you want to adjust the position of the brush over the commutator, it will help you a lot to minimize the sparking that is occurring at the brushes. So you will see a glowish glow will be there due to the short circuit of the brushes at the brushes. So you can just change the position. So end housing that we have seen, it attached to the end of the main frame and support the bearings. The front housing support and the bearing and the brush assemblies, whereas the rear housing usually support the bearings only. So at the end, when you see that this is your whole stator part, which is having a commutator, brush, as well as the armature, and you will be having a rotor which is rotating. So all this part will be present inside the main frame, and here you have the end fittings or end housings will be there. So what are bearings? So bearings are usually made up of ball or roller bearing that are fitted in the end of the housing. Their function is to reduce the friction. So this friction has to reduce between the rotating and stationary part of the machine, because both the rotating part and the stationary part are there, which are in close proximity. So there will be a friction, so it will reduce it. Mostly high carbon steel is used for the construction of bearing, and it is very hard material. Now comes the shaft. So shaft is made up of mild steel with a maximum breaking strength, because the shaft is the one which is rotating, taking the load also. So it will be made up of steel, and it will be having a maximum breaking strength, used to transfer the mechanical power from or to the machine. So shaft can take the electrical to mechanical or mechanical to electrical, that is the energy transfer. So it has to be highly strength, high breaking strength has to be there. The rotating part like armature core, commutator, cooling fan, etc. are keyed to the shaft. So all these rotating part are being connected with the shaft. So we have discussed the constructional features and essential parts of the DC machine, and it is very important to know all these parts so that we understand the working principle of the DC machine. थैंक यू।